Okay, we're going to be covering Matthew 4 and Luke 4 primarily. If you've got your scriptures with you, we can kind of just run down the verses and go over this. So if you get a chance, grab those scriptures. All right, Matthew 4 and Luke 4, they open up in, it's like a vision. This is something very similar to what, for example, Lehi has. He has at least a couple of visions in the Book of Mormon. John the Revelator in the Book of Revelation has a revelation. Daniel has these visions or dreams. This is kind of what's happening with Jesus. He's ready to go off and start the thrust of his ministry. But in order to do that, he wants to separate himself and go out into the wilderness and be with God, which is an important principle to understand. He has this visionary experience. And if you recall when Nephi has his vision, he says, I can't recall if I was in or out of the body, and it doesn't really matter to him. I think the best way to understand these visions is, number one, to put yourself in the shoes of those that are receiving the vision. So put yourself in the shoes of Jesus for a moment here. And what I mean by that is, imagine it's you. Don't look at this as a historical event and something that just Jesus went through, but imagine that you are going through this and that you're in this drama or this vision that is happening. And then secondly, I think it's important to look at it as if it's a dream. So imagine that you are having this dream. What would it mean for you? What are the principles and truths that you would be able to glean from this type of a dream if you had it? What would it be trying to tell you? I think that's a good way to look at this. So Jesus goes off, or in the body or in the spirit, he's off in the desert. The Joseph Smith translation says that he goes off to be with God, not that he goes off to be tempted. He goes off to be with God, and Satan then comes and tempts him. So we're going to go through, starting with verse 1 here in Matthew 4. It says, "Then Jesus was led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil," or to be with God. Think of the Exodus. A lot of the authors, including in the Book of Mormon, will write similar to the Book of Exodus and what was happening there. And notice that he goes to the wilderness in this vision, which is where John the Baptist was and where John the Baptist was preaching. It's always out in the wilderness. It's always in an area where it's not mainstream civilization, because mainstream civilization is not a good representation of the kingdom of God. You have to separate yourselves. Babylon and even Jerusalem here are not of the Lord, so to speak. So in verse 2, it says, "And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward and hungered." Again, think of the children of Israel. They go out into the wilderness, and they are out there for 40 years. Not 40 days, but they're out there for 40 years. Now, fasting is an interesting thing, and it's something I've learned a lot about in the last couple of years. I used to think that all this meant was the 40 days meant a long time, and it does. 40, the number 40 can oftentimes mean just a long time. But the more I've looked into fasting, especially anciently, this was a typical thing to do. This was a thing. In fact, if you look all the way back to Pythagoras of the Pythagorean theorem from Greece, he was in Egypt learning, becoming an initiative of a mystic group. And he had to fast for 40 days in Egypt. When he came back to Greece and he had initiates come through his program, they would fast for 40 days. So this was a thing that you would do. And it's probably because if you go much beyond that, you risk death at that point. But you can do a fast, a water fast. That means that you are drinking water only. You can certainly do for 40 days. Believe it or not, the longest period on record is over 370 days on a water fast. And now that was a 400-pound man that had some weight to lose, but it can be done. So he's out fasting for 40 days, and he's out in the desert. And when verse 3, when the tempter came to him, he said, "If thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread." I think the question here is not necessarily about his divinity, although it could be as well. And the Come Follow Me manual is asking that question Is Satan actually asking about his divinity here? Is he asking about his role as a son of God? I think the temptation is more, it sounds to me, it's more one of pride. So if he's asking, hey, if you're the son of God, turn these stones here into bread. And, you know, you're probably hungry. You've been fasting for a long time. Why don't you go ahead and do this? You've got the power to do this. I think that that's a little bit more where this line of questioning is going, and it is as I see it. And we'll follow through on that here as we move down the chapter here. But he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Okay, again, this is going back to the typology of the Exodus, where man did live by bread, and it was God that was providing the bread for their physical sustenance, right? So that they could live. But Christ now is saying, that's the physical side of things. That's the Old Testament. This is the New Covenant. We're talking about something spiritual here. Man doesn't live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Then the devil taketh him up into the holy city and setteth him on a pinnacle of the temple. Joseph Smith translation has the Spirit taking him up, or God taking him up to the pinnacle, and then Satan comes up to him. And Satan says to him and saith, if thou be the Son of God, so he's asking again, hey, if you're the Son of God, cast yourself down. And then lastly, Satan says to him, he shows him the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them. And then in verse 9 he says, and he saith unto him, all these things will I give thee if thou wilt fall down and worship me. Now think of Moses's experience in Moses 1. It's very, very similar. It's a very similar situation. And this is where I'm going with this line of questioning here. And it applies to each one of us. In the Moses experience on the mountain, kind of out in the wilderness, if you will, he's with God at first, just like Jesus is, and he is exposed to the glory of God. And then Satan comes, and Moses says, where is your glory? I don't see your glory. I can discern between you and God. Who are you that I should worship you? So Satan asks Moses the same thing he asks Jesus and says, or tells him, worship me. And in response, Moses says, I can discern between the two of you. I'm not going to worship you. And Satan gets all mad and frustrated. And in verse 10, Jesus responds to Satan. Then saith Jesus unto him, get thee hence, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. Okay, so here's the line of questioning. And looking again at the experience with Moses, I think we get a good example of some context as to what this line of questioning is about. Imagine again, this is you, and you have been exposed to the glory of God. How might you have been exposed to the glory of God? Well, do you have the gospel? Do you have the principles and truths of the scriptures, of living prophets that have given you guidance? Do you have, perhaps you do, perhaps you don't, but perhaps you have parents or siblings that are good examples to you, that provide you with a spiritual fountain of truth and guidance. And you've been exposed to this, and you have all of this. And now Satan comes along, or friends, or other lines of thought and philosophies, ideologies, and say, hey, they don't say worship me, but they say, follow me, follow my ideology, follow my line of thinking, worship me, which really just means put me at the top of your values hierarchy. Make sure I'm at the top. And, you know, you can keep the stuff your parents taught you, or the stuff that you learn at church, or that you have, that you've learned in the scriptures, but, you know, just drop it down a little bit below it. It's right down here. Just keep it right over here. And by changing that values hierarchy now, you are now worshiping that ideology, or you are worshiping the new philosophy, or whatever it might be. That's us, and that's the situation that we oftentimes find ourselves in. And the power that we have is the knowledge that we've been given in the gospel, that knowledge, that precious knowledge of truth in the gospel, and of testimony, and of the Spirit that we've been given. Yet we can easily put that aside or lower that in our values and put something else above it, where we start worshiping something else. So, for example, this happens a lot, it happens to all of us when we go through becoming a teenager and we start yearning for independence and our own thoughts. Great thing. That's a great thing to have. So imagine you're a new teenager or you are a teenager at any age and you're trying to express this identity and this independence and you are subject to many other lines of thought and new ideas and new practices and lots of things might come up on the internet. You have an opportunity to choose at that point. That's important. You need that opportunity to make your own choices. But you have the power of having the ability to discern. Can I discern what I have been given in my life or what I see in the scriptures, what I see and feel when I pray, what I have felt when I've been at church and studied the gospel, when I have served others and focused on important things? Can I discern between the goodness of that and these other things that I'm exposed to? That's, I think, what we're learning here. That's what Jesus is going through at a very high level. The power I have is the knowledge and the experience that I've been given and the agency that I have to decide if I'm going to follow the right things or not. So Jesus is going through this right now. Satan is asking him, hey, if this is you and you have all of this information, you have all of this glory, you have the Spirit, you've had all of these things been given to you, hey, prove it. You know, hey, you've got this agency, you've got this choice, you've got this freedom, you have this power. Go out and show me that you actually have the power, that you actually have the ability to choose and choose something different. It's a temptation. Or then the next stage might be you're beyond a teenager, you're a new adult, and you're out in the world, and it's a question of, okay, who are the friends that I'm going to make? My adult new friends, who are they going to be? And can I discern between what is good and what might not be as good? Can I create that world around me that is going to allow me to have the Spirit and to be able to commune with God? Or am I going to create a world where I worship something else, where my hierarchy is a value that is different from what I learn in the scriptures and what I learn from my testimony and from feeling the Spirit? I think that's a good way of looking at what Jesus is going through at a different level. We all go through that. We are in his shoes. We have this scenario in our lives all of the time. In pop culture, we can think of a couple of examples of this principle that plays out. For example, in Star Wars, you have Darth Vader. Early on in Star Wars, Darth Vader is trying to get Luke Skywalker to cross over to the dark side. He's saying, look, use your power, what you have. You have this power. I admit you have this power, but try this out. Try coming over here a little bit. You know, he blatantly talks about coming over to the dark side, but it's not usually that clear, right, for us. But that's what his invitation is. The other example would be in Harry Potter, where you have Voldemort, where Voldemort goes out and ends up recruiting several characters to come over to his side, to be on the dark side. Same type of thing. Well, these are people that could be good at first, but Voldemort tries to turn them and saying, hey, try this over here. Let me show you a different way. Hoping that those characters will not discern between the goodness that they have already seen and the darkness of the chaos that they're about to step into. And of course, Jesus is the greatest example. Sometimes it's hard, I think, to look at him in certain ways because he was perfect as an exemplar, right? Because he's so far ahead of us. But here he gives us an example of if we step into his shoes here and we walk through the same scenario, he gives us the example that he turns down the temptation, right? He doesn't say, oh, well, I can try this over here. I can step over here. Why not try out using my power here? why not try out using my agency to choose something different? And what is it that Satan is offering him? He's offering him the things of the world. So these other ideologies, these other practices, behaviors, lines of thought are things of the world that Satan has to offer. They're a lower way of living. They don't offer the greater blessings and the greater fulfillment in our lives. So here, in resisting that temptation, even Jesus is having faith. He is trusting in the principles that he has already gathered from probably Joseph and Mary and through prayer and experience and service and reading the scriptures. This internal core that he has developed, he's going to stick with it. In conclusion, we can see the importance of separating ourselves to try and be with God, to be in a state of introspection and looking at ourselves when we have a mission that we need to accomplish, whatever that might be in our life. We have an objective, a righteous objective to achieve. It could be school. It could be career. It could be family. Whatever that might be, we need to separate ourselves, have some introspection, some sacrifice, and try and fill ourselves with the Spirit as much as possible to prepare ourselves to go out and achieve that righteous objective.